everyone. I'm Gary Nall. This is the Progressive Commentary Hour. Our topic, how the mindfulness movement has become the new capitalist spirituality. My guest, Professor Ronald Purser, a professor at San Francisco State University. He teaches mindfulness in organizations and theories of consumer capitalism, social change, and transformation. He is also a Zen teacher in the Korean Taego tradition. His essays and cultural criticisms have appeared in Salon, Tycoon, Tricycle, and the Huffington Post and Alternet. Ron has authored 8 books, his most recent one, which has raised a stir in the American spiritual community, is McMindfulness, How Mindfulness Became the New Capitalist Spirituality. And which, by the way, critiques the popular and increasing fad of mindfulness meditation being co-opted by neoliberal corporate and political interest. He also has a doctorate from Case Western Reserve University, and his website is Ron Purser, that's P-U-R-S-E-R.com. Nice to have you with us today, Ron.
Gary, thank you.
Ron, I did a program today for all of our syndicated stations involving the young 16-year-old Greta Thunberg, who is leading a worldwide effort of some 4.5 to 5 million people, mainly young people, teenagers, who went out on strike on Friday to protest the lack of any honest or authentic effort on the part of governments, and except for some exceptions around the world, and corporations, and even individuals. She was angry, and I believe rightly so. And we sent her 13 articles, 3 documentaries on the environment based upon decades of research so that she was aware of specific issues. And one of my friends, Tony Lyons, who is married to a Swedish woman and speaks Swedish fluently, was able to get these into her hands. Now that's good, and I support her, and I believe that we should have many more young people speaking up and out and being equally as outraged, but without the rage. I believe being outraged, you get your message out. And in effect, what you're saying, what she is saying, is that we don't trust you. You've had all these decades to do something, you've done nothing. And then I pulled back and said, let us not conflate two issues. I fully support Greta and all the younger young people being concerned because the future they're facing, based upon what we who are in the environmental movement, climate movement, know, is a dire outcome. We're just finishing the most comprehensive documentary that I'm aware of ever done on the subject of the environment, not just global warming. And today we had to do a whole new section on global dimming, and it's devastating. Because I'll just briefly, as an aside, explain this if you're not aware of this. All of our efforts for the last 50 to 60 years to get corporations to use different forms of catalyst devices to eliminate or lessen particulate matter going out of smokestacks into the air, stop using refrigerants, and start going towards more natural and non-toxic ways of helping live our lives. And now we're just being told that the newest science shows that the dimming, because what happens is all those particulate matter goes in the air, it shields the sun from coming directly in, and in effect is causing the sun to reflect back into space. But when we succeed at creating less air pollution, we increase the amount of heat coming, and they underestimated the amount of heat that will hit the Earth. No one knew this. All the mathematical models are wrong. And they did this by an Israeli scientist found that 3 days of no flying in the United States after 9/11, there was a huge difference in the weather, in the temperature, based upon those thousands of airplanes not being over the United States for just 3 days. So we're now faced with a whole new set of problems. So in any case, my point is that yes, we have a lot to be concerned with, and no, we do not see the environmental groups by and large, we do not see corporations, we do not see the government doing anything, so it's going to resolve itself. We either succeed or fail in the future based upon what individuals choose to do individually and collectively at the local level. Hopefully at some point they might influence others to do so in government. Now, why is that important? Because it's important because behind Greta is an enormous industry. And I expose this industry today. Keeping in mind, I support her. I support her message. If anything, it's understated. But all the people around her, and we're talking about massive amounts of people, Bill Gates and George Soros and Al Gore, these people want to control where all the money goes for our interest in the environment, and it's not about saving the planet. These are not vegans. These are not people going to plant trees. These are not people going to tell people not to use electronic devices, as she could get young people to get away from it. So someone who comes with purity, intensity, the desire to see change where there has not been change, behind her is a whole group of neocons, of people who support globalization, who have a neoliberal agenda. And that brings me to our topic. Today, yoga and many practices of meditation, notably mindfulness, or what is known as Vipassana in Sanskrit, has become increasingly secularized and researched and promulgated as remedies for many of our social ills, such as stress and anxiety and attention deficit and learning. But I'd like to start by going back further, before mindfulness and yoga became cultural fads, because we trace this back to the 1960s and 70s, a period I was a part of when we were giving a forum on my radio show to people who had these thoughts, like Krishnamurti. I knew Krishnamurti very well. And they were offering us spiritual practices and new forms of psychology. I knew Carmi Harari, Alan Shepard, Alan Putterman, Albert Ellis, Elaine Kahn. These were people I knew very well. We talked, we socialized, and they were critical thinkers. We had Alan Watts and the Hindu gurus like Sri Chinmoy, who came to the West. Then there were also those early pioneers who ventured outside of the Eastern tradition to introduce more secular spirituality that would contribute to what we think of as the New Age in the 1980s and 90s. Those were people like Michael Murphy and George Leonard, and who founded Eslon, Michael Murphy did, and Leonard Orr and Gene Houston, wonderful human being, one of the smartest people I've ever met, male or female, and her brother is a longtime close friend of mine, early collaborator on one of the most important articles we ever wrote, The Politics of Cancer. Marilyn Ferguson, who wrote The Aquarian Conspiracy. And Fritjof Capra, of course, who wrote The Turning Point. Now, so when we consider the problems of mindfulness taken outside of its spiritual, ethical context, which we'll speak about in a few moments, do you see the mindfulness craze as being a natural development of what was started in the 1960s and 70s? And do you see any correlation between what is happening now with a movement of young, more idealistic people becoming vegan and starting to minimize their purchases in their life, trying to get off the grid wherever possible, versus the people behind them who are saying, yeah, make the world go crazy with fear, and then when people start to open up the big checkbooks, the governments, we're going to be there for carbon capture. So you have a dichotomy today. The idealists who are giving us the right message at the right time with the right energy and intensity, and young people doing it, which awakens them. They were asleep. Versus, and then compare that to the young idealists of the 1960s and 70s, and what later would become the substantial commercialization of that movement as well. If you understand my question, please address it. The forum is yours. Take your time.
Oh, sure. I think there's an interesting parallel that you make, because if we go back to the 60s, early 70s, I mean, that's what really took me by surprise, the so-called mindfulness revolution. I was baffled to see how the Buddhist spiritual path, which has been around for several millennia, suddenly just morphed into a very profitable industry. I think the U.S. meditation market, I just saw this recently the other day, is estimated to be valued at $1.5 billion. And the market data forecast that it'll grow to over $2 billion by 2022. So there's an incredible monetary interest in commercializing and commodifying what essentially was a very countercultural, anti-establishment movement back in the 60s and 70s. It was embraced by Allen Ginsberg and the beat writers, Jack Kerouac, the bohemian artist, and people like Alan Watts, as you said, very anti-establishment, anti-materialist movement, suddenly became co-opted into this $1.5 billion industry. And now you have mindfulness teachers going to the World Economic Forum in Davos. So I think there is a parallel, Gary, as you laid it out so clearly, that there are monetary interests behind the technocratic wing, that, you know, there's big money to be made through technocratic solutions. I think that might be sort of the direction that you're alluding to. So it's interesting that we have a society that is based on capitalism, and we can see how Asian spiritualities have historically been co-opted and commodified and turned into basically highly individualistic self-help techniques, which can be sold on the marketplace. And that's why I call it a capitalist spirituality, how it's been transformed into a capitalist spirituality. There's over 1,000 meditation apps, for example, on the market. Headspace is one of the leading, Headspace and Calm. Headspace is valued at over $300 million now, I think. Even in New York City and Los Angeles, you have for-profit meditation studios now where you can go online and choose your cushion and where you want to sit beforehand. It is an industry, and within industry, you have market forces at work, which basically will neuter these practices, domesticate them, and reorient them, reshape and refashion these practices, in my opinion, to reproduce the very capitalist structural injustices that that we're trying to eradicate. So in a way, mindfulness is ideologically, unfortunately, been co-opted, and it's being used to help accommodate to the status quo. And that's really what—that's really where my critique is aimed at—is more of the ideological co-optation of mindfulness. I'm not criticizing anyone because that is getting individual level benefit from mindfulness. There's tremendous therapeutic benefit from secular mindfulness programs and. But when you see it move into other domains, such as corporations and the U.S. military, then, you know, I think then we can, you know, clearly see how these techniques have been completely co-opted as a privatized spirituality. And they're being used in many ways to pacify feelings of anxiety and pacify feelings of resentment in the workplace, they're basically putting the burden on individuals to adjust and accommodate to what amounts to extremely toxic corporate cultures. So we haven't really looked critically at how the rhetoric and the dominant discourse in the field is basically one of what I call the privatization of stress. And it's kind of a medicalization model, a biomedical model, which sees stress purely through the lens of being a physiological or maladaptive response to the environment. And what that does is it obscures other narratives that could help people to make sense of stress and make sense of the suffering that they're feeling, that it's not always an individual problem, because that then amounts to a form of victim blaming. And it kind of deflects attention away from the social and political aspects, which are causing so much stress in our society in the first place. So I think that we have to apply our critical thinking to what's actually going on. And as you mentioned, in the 60s and 70s, there was a ferment about trying to critically think through the materialistic capitalist system which was occurring, and it just, like Esalen, let's look at Esalen. You mentioned Michael Murphy. Esalen used to be the hotbed of consciousness exploration and anti-materialist, anti-capitalist sort of dialogues that were going on there. But now Silicon Valley has taken over Esalen in some ways. The president of, not the president, but the person who runs Esalen now is actually a former Google project manager. You know, I think back in the 60s and 70s, it was quite affordable to go to Esalen and take a workshop from Fritz Perls or whoever was teaching at the time. But now, to spend a weekend at Esalen, it cost you $3,000. And you could probably get away with about $450 if you camp. But I mean, it's just incredible how these countercultural centers have been completely turned around and become sort of playgrounds for the elites. So I think there's definitely a parallel to what you said about Greta, and I never thought of it that way. I never really considered that, but now that you've raised that issue, it's very interesting, Gary.
Well, we've actually documented. We actually went to the people behind her. We started seeing the same people in all of her photographs. And then, being a person who's been in the public eye for over half a century, as I have, and all the different forms you could imagine, I ask, how difficult would it be, even as a best-selling author, take any author in America today, to make a call and suddenly in 1 week you can meet the former president of the United States, Barack Obama. You can meet the Pope. You can meet the president of France. You can talk to the entire parliament of France. You can talk to Davos at the World Economic Forum. You can talk to the entire British parliament. You can talk to the British prime minister. You can talk with Jane Goodall. These do not happen in the real world ever. I don't care if you're Martin Luther King or Gandhi. It doesn't happen. This has to be orchestrated. And a 16-year-old doesn't orchestrate. She doesn't have that intellect. She is filled with passion and purpose. Great, I support that. But then I just saw a interview she did, and this has not appeared anywhere. And a friend sent me this, and it was an hour where some of these young females, teenagers, were being asked some questions. And every question she was asked that was not a part of her talking point, she simply could not answer. She had no intellectual context to answer these. Then I start finding, who's this woman? Look here. This is a woman who's now a handler. And then we find out who the woman is. We identify her. Then we identify the one foundation that she's associated with. Then we find out there's no time left, another foundation. Then we have like nine other foundations and the same people. These are billionaires. These are industrialists. These are energy companies. We're talking about polluting energy companies. There's PR firms, there're law firms, there's agencies, and they're by the dozens. So we get them, we go inside, we get every one of their names and who they are. And today I started, over the next 5 days, I'm showing you who's behind her. Again, this is in no way, shape, or form a criticism of her, because I respect her, I'm honoring what she's doing, we've sent her all the material, but I'm separating out my support for her and her message, and hopefully she has that message that she shares. But right now, someone's doing all the writing for her of all this, and they're not giving you the facts. The real environmentalists, who should be at every one of these forums, and as a guest speaker too, who's there, who's in the field, like a Guy McPherson, and I could name 30 others. We have them in our new film. These are the people who, no matter what it is, acidification of the ocean, or the melting of Antarctica and Arctic melting and global dimming, these are the people who have all the facts at hand. Not a single person, not one human being on the entire planet who knows what the hell's going on has been in a single one of these news stories, press conferences, or meetings at any of these forums. Now that immediately, unless your IQ is below 7, that should immediately set up a red flag saying, hold on, you're yelling at people because of what they're doing is causing pollution. You're telling them that they're not good, that they've abandoned their responsibility, which is always true. But do you think any of these forums would allow anyone to come in and insult them? Do you think they would allow to be embarrassed? They're applauding this person, giving her awards that she hasn't done anything to deserve, like an Amnesty International Award, and the Nobel Peace Prize. My God, that if they're going to do that, then that means it's as worthless as the day they give it to Barack Obama. So you have to see beyond this, and I'll show you where I'm going with this. So today, and I'm going to tie this into something that happened years ago you'll find interesting, I hope. But today I gave suggestions for Greta, practical suggestions, not for Greta, but for an entire generation. And that is that don't invest in any green program sponsored by Al Gore or Bono and these other neocons and these neoliberal people, because they're just looking to control it. These are all neoliberal capitalist models. And the idea that we're going to have eternal growth, and that's what these people want in the corporate green movement. They believe in infinite growth and monetary capital. They want a carbon tax. That means that Al Gore and other people's hedge funds will act as brokers on changing money from a very polluting country like China. They can print money all at once, pay it fine, and therefore say, well, we're doing our bit for the globe. We're continuing growing at a massive rate, but we're paying in money. It doesn't count. So divest from companies relying upon fossil fuels, weaning ourselves off products, notably electronics. Wouldn't it be a really cool thing for a group of young people, boys and girls together, to say that, look, that cell phone, that 5G cell phone, which is a major environmental contaminant, That's rare earth minerals that had to be exploited by slave labor in Africa. But you don't see that. By company employees at Foxconn in China that have jumped off the building so many times because they're exploited and overworked that they put safety nets. You tell that to someone who's impressionable, that sticks in their mind. And you tell them that we don't want agricultural products anymore. We don't want GMOs. We want green solutions that are not commercial-based. Get rid of your smart meters. Switch to a vegan diet. Everything that can reduce energy consumption. Change to efficient light bulbs. Install heat pumps in homes. Unplug electronic appliances like TVs and computers. But also green transportation like riding a bike, flying less, car sharing, and adapt a minimalist lifestyle. And take advantage of secondhand markets and become more conscious at recycling. And buy hemp products, hemp wood to build from, hemp clothing, and hemp nutrition products. So, and plant trees. Those are some of the suggestions I gave her. Now, hopefully, she will talk about them, but I'll bet anything that the people around her are going to say, no, we've got to go in a different direction. And then they're going to guide this whole movement. Now, I give you that for this reason, because let's go back to the 1960s. One of my very closest lifetime friends also was very much an environmentalist. He was one of the two or three wealthiest men in California. He was right up there with J. Paul Getty. And he earned it the old-fashioned way, not through hedge funds or equity partnerships. And his house was like Esalen, where all the minds you could imagine would come there every single night. And he had a special apartment that had been his mother's apartment until she passed upstairs in this beautiful home that had been brought over from Italy, brick by brick, and reestablished. It's the most beautiful home in Hollywood. And he was a very practical, down-to-earth, common-sense type of person. But I was there when I went up and I said, Bernie, let's go up and see Krishnamurti. Okay, so we drove up to Ojai, about an hour and a half or so north of Los Angeles. Outside of where there was no room in a spa, every room had been taken because of Krishnamurti being there, this field, this almond mountain, little, not a mountain, hills, was just packed with people. I'm guessing 2,000 people. And up at the top was Krishnamurti. And he was speaking. And it was interesting because he said, you know, we got there a little late, and he said, I'm going to take a little break now, but remember, you're here to meditate, to fast, and to connect with nature. So he gets up out of his chair, goes down, and going to be gone for an hour or two. Immediately upon him leaving, everybody pulls out food, starts smoking cigarettes, drinking beer, talking. I didn't see anybody meditating or fasting. So I went down and I said hello, and I won't go into our friendship, but it was a very quality friendship. And I said, do you really think these people are changing? And he said, no. He said, I have to honor my spiritual commitment. So whether they choose to learn or not, that's for them. I'm not here to be their guru. I had a chance to be the guru, and he could have arguably been the most important guru, right up there with Gandhi, who also didn't want to be a guru, but a different mindset altogether. But he was fully aware that even the people coming to sit there and listen to him talk were there for reasons other than actually transforming their lives. Now jump back down to my friend's house. He liked to think of it as a Gertrude Stein, 1930s, a salon where T.H. Lawrence and T.S. Eliot and Gertrude Stein would all come together and share great ideas, like you mentioned, like some of the beatniks and Kuryak and Ginsberg, etc., and Snyder also, Michael Snyder. So anyhow, I saw those who were legitimate, and I saw those who were there because they saw an opportunity. Now here's my point. Very famous person who would have multiple best-selling books was asking everybody for ideas. So I gave her an idea. I won't tell you the idea I gave her, but I gave her the entire idea. 7 months later, there's her book, and it became a national bestseller. She didn't have any idea what I was talking about. She had no background in the field, but that didn't help keep her from creating a false resume. And she became one of the most powerful people in the New Age movement, but also about six other people who had best-selling books and were marketed and lots of money to go to their workshops, you know, a three-day intensive, and then out of that came Tony Robbins. And I'm thinking, wow. Now, I had a chance to be there at the beginning. I had a chance to meet those who were legitimate, and none of them that were legitimate, not one person that I saw who was legitimate, was looking to commercialize on it. None of them wanted to become famous and to get rich. So, Ronald, from the very beginning, the movement was captured by those who would take other people's ideas and exploit them for their own interests, including one of America's most famous authors, who had, I think, 12 best-selling books, made hundreds of millions of dollars, and celebrities would pay tens of thousands of dollars to go and meditate with him at the beach. And once, I think it was Demi Moore, paid $75,000 to go meditate, then Goldie Hawn or someone else, and suddenly there were so many people, celebrities, those people who feel entitled. And I'm thinking, my God, and this is a guy that I actually invited to come to one of my workshops and look at how he's exploited everything for money. And he was not alone. So what we see is we see the people who created original thoughts, who were dynamic, but weren't commercial. Their ideas were, every one of them was exploited by people who were in it for the money. And that's why the movement lost a lot of its integrity. That's why you keep recycling the same themes over and over. Just like today with the meditation, going up. You could go upstate and you could go to a Buddhist, you know, monastery and do meditation for almost nothing. And if you didn't have any money, you could work or something. Try that today. Try going any of the places you used to go just to do yoga and see what it cost you. So I have never seen the legitimacy, ever. And I'm not talking about a person listening to other people complain about it. I'm talking about a person who was there from the beginning and through every stage of it. Your thoughts, please.
Yeah, it's remarkable. I think what we're seeing now is the self-care elite, celebrities. I just saw an article, I think it was just yesterday, how the 1% now has become spiritual snobs. I mean, you have like the CEO of Twitter, Jack Dorsey, who goes off on a private island, does this 10-day silent retreat. I think he went to Myanmar. And then he gets back on Twitter and brags about it. I mean, it's to me, a lot of kind of corporate virtue signaling in a way. It's really remarkable how this trend is. I heard that the self-improvement market now is pegged at about $10 billion now. There's people like. I paid a lot of attention to what was going on at Davos in the last 2 to 3 years. Now, that's the World Economic Forum, where all the corporate moguls, the global economic elites kind of assemble for a week, venture capitalists, heads of state. There are lots of parties and everything. But, the mindfulness contingent showed up there a couple of years ago, and they were quite a hit. And I think that should make us pause, is when the 1%, the elites, global elites, warmly receive these mindfulness teachers, we have to ask the question, what's in it for them? What's going on? And there's a particular person that his name is, I'll name names. His name is William George. And He used to run a company called Medtronics. He was the CEO of Medtronics, quite wealthy. He went to the Harvard Business School. And then once he retired, I think he probably was a patron, and they gave him an executive position there, kind of a executive in residence. And he's been one of the outspoken people about mindful leadership. It's going around making a lot of talks about mindful leadership. Well, guess what? He sits on the boards of Goldman Sachs, ExxonMobil, and Novartis. And it's interesting that even Goldman Sachs now has a mindfulness program. So this is kind of the trickle-down theory of mindfulness. You know, the idea that if we train mindful leaders, people at the top, that'll trickle down to the rest of the corporation, and these corporations like Goldman Sachs will suddenly become more humane. They'll become more socially and environmentally responsible. But if you look at George's affiliation with Goldman Sachs and ExxonMobil, a friend of mine who's probably the pioneer in socially engaged Buddhism, David Loy, he wrote Bill George an open letter a few years back, asking him, hey, how is your meditation practice? How's that working out in terms of the influence it's having on corporate social responsibility and your role on these boards? And he listed a long litany of unethical business practices at ExxonMobil and Goldman Sachs. And George never replied. He never replied to his letter. So I think that speaks, that kind of silence speaks louder than words. And so I think that there's an interesting, this is just my own speculation, Gary, but I think Greta Thunberg is a threat. And so these corporate forces are swooping in to try to co-opt her. I think that's the point you're making.
That is part of the point I'm making. Just extend your thought, Ron. I believe that you would never get invited to Davos if you offered any legitimate challenge to any of them. You will never see a Chris Hedges. You will never see an Abby Martin. You will never see a Cornel West. You will never see any of the 200 or 300 really bright brains we have who are willing to expose the inequalities that exist every day in our lives and the contradictions. The only reason that you would get invited is if they could use you to then control the media, which they do. They've captured all government regulatory agencies, have captured the media. They control the media because some of the people going to Davos are also from the major media. The people who go to Bilderberg are all major media, and they're never allowed to talk about anything that was discussed there. So when you have people who will fly 5,000 private jets to Davos, who some own equity partners, and you know what an equity partnership is, right? Yes. They buy corporations. They load it with debt. They strip off its assets. They fire people. They take the trademark or whatever was important about their purchase, ship it over to China, and they can wipe out an entire group of people's livelihoods. And they do this. And yet they will go in virtue signal at Davos because they bring in someone to do meditation or yoga. And or they'll bring in someone to talk about how bad the environment is, and these are the very people contributing to the environment. I can assure you that the number one eaten thing at Davos was not brown rice, it was steak, or exotic fish, or quail. These are not the people that you ever, ever are going to see from Goldman Sachs, or Citicorp, or ABC, NBC, CBS, MBC, none of these people, and they're about... Richard Gale and I have actually want to know how many people represent an existential threat to the quality of life on this planet. 10 million millionaires and 17 million professionals. all highly educated, the professionals are, lawyers, doctors, engineers, architects, and they're entitled spoiled families, and their only interest in life is increasing their standard of living. So then you have Leonardo DiCaprio getting an award from River Keepers, flying from the Cannes Film Festival to New Jersey on a private jet, picking up the award and flying back to Cannes, and then going out on, I think it was David Geffen's or someone's mega yacht, major polluter. And no one sees the contradictions. And we have nothing but these powerful, wealthy people, from hedge fund people to corporate titans to celebrities, the Gwyneth Paltrows, and all they do is commercialize every single thing in their sight. It's like they are sociopathically imbued with a gene that says, if I can exploit it, I have a responsibility to do so. So Greta's just the newest thing. And historically, I saw the same thing. I'm not a fan of Tony Robbins. I see the exploitation. I've seen the exploitation of so many of these people. And I do not see historically any legitimacy to these movements. And I certainly don't see any legitimacy to any of the virtue signaling today in our society. I think that people would be wise not to give their financial support, their political support, or their energy support to people who are just there to take advantage of, no matter how gift-wrapped their personas are. Your thoughts, please.
Yeah, it's interesting. I don't know if you remember. Do you remember the Dutch historian who is at Davos, Rutger Bregman? He was there, I think, he was there about a year ago. He was an invited speaker, and he called them out. It was a completely blindsided them. He said, you know, what is all this stuff about resilience and mindfulness? And he says, why don't you people just pay your taxes? You know? And he really created an uproar. He was on Fox News. I think he was interviewed by Tucker Carlson. I think it was an outtake. I don't think it was actually aired, but he called him a moron. I mean, Tucker Carlson called Rutger Bregman a moron. It's really remarkable, Gary, that that's something that is designed to uproot the ego, a practice, an ancient practice, a spiritual practice, which was aimed to eradicate greed, eradicate selfishness, eradicate ill will and anger, has been completely co-opted to actually reinforce these very poisons. And it's served an ideological function now in terms of propping up capitalist relations and perpetuating the status quo. It is kind of almost sickening to see that happening. But I think what you're talking about, Gary, is just how financialization, which doesn't produce anything, it just pushes the burden on future generations. And to me, we really do have to exert our critical intelligence to see through the charades, to see through how the corporate forces are, and the marketing savvy, behind these corporate forces can be such a powerful force in terms of selling this stuff. It's a selling spirituality, basically. It's a corporate takeover of spirituality, in my opinion.
I see it also in the new type of Buddhism. I've seen so many people who practice Buddhism and avow themselves to be Buddhists who are completely unethical, have no moral base at all. But they'll run out and do their classes and then ask them to be responsible, and they shrug that responsibility. Ask them, what have you done without charging someone? What have you done to go in and help the poor? What have you done to go in and help the homeless? What have you done? Well, you know, they'll run out and meditate and rub their belly and head. It's all of this is crap. It's just all of cheap-ass burlesque. We've got real issues in life, and practicing something doesn't make you a better person. Helping other people shows who you are, and I'm sick and tired of people escaping into Zen or Jainism or Hinduism or Buddhism or some ism as if somehow that's a substitute for making authentic and honest and moral choices in life. It's escape of cowards, in my opinion. And I've been seeing this the entire New Age movement. That's why you don't ever hear New Age people on my show. I won't have them on. I will not insult the intelligence of my audience. I won't give forms to these clowns. You'll never hear Tony Robbins on my show, nor many of these other people, because I know the difference is I'm not a spectator. I'm there. I've been there. So I've been able to communicate with these people at different times, hoping that some would be authentic. And indeed, the people who are authentic, those are the people I bring on. Because they're not coming on because of it enhances their power. You go to Davos because you're meeting other people who are going to enhance your power. They're going to talk deals. And these are people who can move money and create debt as leverage. They make debt an asset, which is a kind of economic alchemy. And it's always someone else's money, but they get it. They get it that no one's going to criticize it for the debts that they accumulate. And these very people will stay at Davos and say, the future is Africa. So they go into Africa with a front person like Bono, and they will buy up tens of thousands of acres that are sustainably helping people there for the millennia eat and sustain themselves. And they'll get rid of the people, generally by force, and then they'll put genetically engineered seeds down, like Bill Gates does. Or they'll go down to South America now that Bolsonaro, that absolute fascist, is president that we support in the United States, and he is just selling off as much of the lungs of the planet, the rainforest, as possible. Now, there are 8 countries that share the rainforest, but Brazil's the largest. But if you want to see climate change tipping faster than ever, watch them killing off one soccer field every 60 seconds in the Amazon, and causing those fires. So those are the people you meet at Davos. So anyone who would have you go to Davos had to know that there was an intent and a motivation and an outcome. And always it's power, control, and profit. Everything else that is gift-wrapped in is just a fraud. Your thoughts, please.
Yeah, well, I think that the marketing of mindfulness too is it's all about me. Now it's all about me. We shouldn't be calling it mindfulness. We should be calling it me-fulness or mindfulness. You know, the so-called mindfulness revolution. There's no revolution. What's been overturned? There's no revolution. It's a complete quietist surrender to the market. It's about enhancing our personal brand. Mindfulness, or MIC mindfulness is what I call it, it's just thriving in a sea of narcissism. And this kind of promising that you're going to be happy if you subscribe to Headspace, right? It's ridiculous. I mean, there's no ethical or moral framework for these instrumental practices, which, you know, are touted now. It'll improve your career success, right? Hedge fund managers are taking, on Wall Street, are taking mindfulness courses. And we haven't even gotten to the U.S. military and how the military has now latched on to it. Over $10 million have been dished out to university centers and to do research on this and to train combatants. We're not talking about people coming back from Iraq or Afghanistan that are suffering from PTSD. No, we're talking about programs that are equipping soldiers to use concentration practices. Let's not even call it mindfulness. It's just a form of attention enhancement training to make better sharpshooters. And, you know, if that's not egregious, I don't know what is, in terms of the lack of morality among some of the scientists behind this.
Since when did you read that all scientists are ethical?
Well, yeah, I know. It's an enterprise. It's an enterprise, and there's competition for
almost
grants.
All of corporate science is predicated upon profit in the end. And yet you see these commercials like March, you know, wear the pink and, you know, curing cancer. Well, show me a case of cancer they cured because you donated to them. No, what everyone is doing out there today who's foolish enough to be involved in this is people have been conditioned to believe that there is something legitimate behind mindfulness as it's being marketed. And people want to be well. People want to have more energy. People want to improve their memory and concentration, reduce anxiety. Those are legitimate, to reduce stress, to deal with depression. However, a study out of Germany, at the University of Essen, since Europeans are much less stressed than Americans, I would imagine if the same survey were conducted here, reduction of stress and anxiety and depression would have a much higher percentage than there. But what do we do here? We privatize everything. We're privatizing stress. We're privatizing the role mindfulness plays to further privatize it. Earlier, tobacco companies did something similar. So this raises a historical and ethical question. Buddha did not teach mindfulness to relieve any of the reasons of stress reduction, or to become more efficient employees, or as you suggest, to become better sharpshooters to kill people, or just general wellness. Buddha did not teach anything so that the rich and powerful, the people control our society and are personally responsible for so much of the excess pollution because they are engaged in far greater consumption. Take a person from the bushmen of the Kalahari and they leave a virtual invisible footprint carbon-wise. Take the average person living in any city in the United States who has advanced degrees and is in a profession, and the more they earn, the more they buy, the more they spend, the more they consume, the more they pollute. And it becomes just a vicious cycle. No, Buddha taught it primarily to help people get out of the trap of going constantly around in circles of self-induced existential suffering and to become more compassionate towards the suffering of others. I don't see any of this, but maybe I'm wrong. Give you an example. Yesterday, I played a tape that went viral of a homeless woman, I'm guessing in her 50s, and she had all of her belongings in a shopping cart, and she was in the subway in Los Angeles. And the police officer was asking about what she does, and she said, well, I'm homeless, and that she sings, or sing something. So for 60 seconds, she sang this beautiful aura from an opera. And you become dumbstruck, and you think, why is she homeless? Well, you don't have to have a beautiful voice to have special insights into life and to have mastered things and end up being homeless. And I thought, there's an opportunity, so I put a challenge out to Jay-Z and Beyonce. They had bought, a $60 million home in Beverly Hills. Surely you could invite this person in and give her a place to stay and help her get on her feet till she can reclaim her life. Now, of course, you interview people to make sure that they're not a threat to you or themselves, but the vast majority are just normal people who have stress in life. Well, if every one of these 16 million professionals and 10 million millionaires, if they each took a person in, we would have no homelessness in the United States. I don't see any of them doing this. So I'm sick of their virtue signaling. I'm sick of the New Age movement. I'm sick of people who just make money off other people's weaknesses and fears. I'm sick of the Oprah Winfrey's and people who become billionaires by exploiting people's trust, but providing with no real concrete way. We have enabled people in the wrong way instead of helping them to gain what the Buddha would, and that is to become aware that share compassion and effort to help those who are suffering. And there's a strong ethical motivation there. So that's what I see. Your final thoughts on this, please.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right that mindfulness has just become a reinforcement of consumer capitalism. And, you know, stress of individuals in America, like compared to the Scandinavian countries, I mean, stress is a public health problem. And they just want to unload it and put it all on individuals without having to look critically at the structural and systemic causes of our cultural malaise. And then at the same time, make tons of money by doing it at the same time. I mean, it's a double ripoff. So this whole idea of conscious capitalism is absurd. You know, it's the idea that spirituality and capitalism can be reconciled. And that's another marketing gimmick that just keeps the missionaries of corporate power in place. And so, you know, I don't think mindfulness should be servants of power, and we need to take it back.
You're right. Let's face it. Popular mindfulness, as it's being commercialized, instead of its authentic use, basically says all the problems begin with ourselves. It's all in our head. And if we have problems with injustices in the outside world, then we're not seeing reality correctly. So at a psychological level, what is being taught in the popularized mindfulness movement that you observe as pacifying people to become better cogs in the capitalist wheel and make them less engaged in the urgent environmental and social struggles we're facing. And it's the case that this commercialized mindfulness is being falsely advertised as being a full awake human being, and that in all there is to life is to being awake and human. And it isn't this mindfulness utopia that its leaders promulgate, actually rather dystopian, and this is just foolish. So I believe that we have been misled, manipulated, and used. I don't see any of these mindful people. I don't see any of these corporate leaders. I don't see any of these professional people day to day engaged in protesting the things that are most important, stopping war in Yemen, stopping all the pollution, stopping all the purchasing, stopping the military-industrial complex, stopping all the politics that are corrupt and all the money going into politics, which further corrupts it, stopping all the drugging of our children. None of this is being addressed. Not one of 100 important issues, but they'll run out and meditate or say, I just went to the Buddhist place, so I must be okay. Nuts to that, friend. Ron, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you, Gary. I really
enjoyed it. Professor Ron Purser, professor up at San Francisco State University, and I give you his website as well. I'm Gary Nall. Thank you all for listening, and have a nice day.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you to cry.